Great. So I'll say hi again. Janice, nice to see you. Welcome. Hey, thank you for talking with us today. I really do appreciate it. You have such an interesting company that you are leading. Maybe if you could just start off by telling me and whoever a little bit about what you're doing now in your company.
Sure. Yeah. So Eikonizo, it's amazing. We are almost 3 years old. So that's hard to imagine. But it's a startup company. We were spun out of Mass General Hospital. There's an academic, a professor, his name is Jacob Hooker. And his, superpower is being able to, he's a chemist and he's able to design small molecules that can get into the brain really well, which is very challenging, but he also is able to design them so that you can use a single radioactive atom in the molecule. And if you have that, that makes what's called a PET ligand. PET stands for positron emission tomography. And you may have seen beautiful images where, you inject this into a person, it goes into their blood, it gets into the brain. And depending on what target it binds in the brain, it lights up the brain wherever that target is. And so that he realized he had a tool for a particular target, and it's called HDAC6, and that stands for histone deacetylase, but it's a protein that's in all of your cells, but it's especially important in neurons, and there's been literature for like 20 years with mice, animals and other cell models showing that if you inhibit that target, you can rescue the growth of neurons, the behavior of neurons, and it has helped in mouse models, diseases like ALS or Lou Gehrig's disease, Alzheimer's models, neuropathy, which is where a lot of people suffer from different types of neuropathy. And so it's been a fantastic target, but the obstacle for getting that from mice into humans is that it's been hard to get a really brain penetrant compound. So in mice, you can just dose way up really high, a level that might be toxic to humans, but it's good enough to use in a mouse model to do what we call proof of concept. But then you're at a dead end because you don't have a molecule that you can translate to humans. So long story short, Jacob had that secret molecule and sauce, and we developed the company to develop that. And we're using not only that PET ligand, but also we're making new molecules that will be used as a therapeutic. And then when we combine those, we have a therapeutic to cure or slow these diseases. And then we have, we can use them in combination with that PET ligand that lights up the brain, so we can actually tell how much of our compound is getting into the brain. And that's been an obstacle, for a lot of other drug companies out there to make drugs against Alzheimer's or ALS. A challenge is, did it actually get to the brain? How much got there? And
There are a lot of BioBuilder students that are super interested in brain, diseases or, therapeutics and things like that. And that is the challenge, right? How do you get something into the brain through your brain is not meant to actually be, readily, taking things up. So that's a very
special. And you can't, unlike for other tissues or if you're targeting most cancers that are in the body, usually a doctor does a biopsy, and you take a little sample of the tumor and you say how much of the drug got in there, or you take a blood sample. But the brain, you can't take a biopsy.
Right.
So it's really a black box.
It is. Hard to get there, hard to know what's going on, hard to treat. And with this very special molecule, you guys have a real tool, as you were saying, you know, to do a lot, which is really pretty amazing. So you have helped build a company around this. You know, I didn't actually let you introduce yourself first, and I'm sorry, because I just find the company so interesting, but certainly you should introduce yourself and what your role is in the company and you know, a little bit more about what you're doing.
Oh, sure. So just to put it in context, the company, you know, the students might not be aware, but we're, you know, three full-time employees. So it's not a huge company. And then we have people who perform different roles, you know, part-time as consultants. Mm-hmm. We do a very small amount of actual what we call wet lab work on our own. A lot of the work is, now there are other companies out there, they're called contract research organizations or CROs, and those are really good at doing, you know, a particular assay or, you know, experiment over and over again. And so a lot of the work that I'm doing and that the other two employees are doing identifying those CROs, which CRO can do the assay that we want with our molecules. And then we, you know, design everything and send things out and requests, and we talk by phone or by email. So it fits into this COVID world very well, where you can actually advance a drug discovery project without having to ourselves be physically at the bench.
Yeah, it's a collaborative world, right? Like we can't all be good at everything, and finding the right people to do the job, especially if you can outsource it and get it done.
Yeah. And so we've been before and during COVID era, we have had collaborators in Cambridge, Massachusetts, which is where we're based, but then also, Delaware, Florida, Michigan, Belgium, France, Israel, China, two different labs in India, California, it really is
one world doing science. Yep.
Yeah.
Amazing.
But my background, I grew up in Illinois, Midwest, and went to college at the University of Illinois, and really liked research. I always liked science through high school and college, and started doing research in college and really liked it. Worked throughout the summer, and then figured, okay, grad school is the next step, applied for a bunch of grad schools. And that's what brought me out to Boston to go to grad school at Harvard. And so I got my PhD. And at that point, I was lucky enough, there were a bunch of startups, and the Boston-Cambridge area was just growing. And so I went straight to a startup company as a research scientist. I met with the founder. There were two founders. They were two MIT professors, one chemist, one biologist. I met with them, you know, in the one guy's office. They didn't even have a lab yet. I just was inspired by the idea. It felt a little more exciting than grad school, you know, than the academic environment. Right. And so that, I say, that was the startup bug for me. There were five, the MIT professor had started several other companies already. Mm-hmm. So he's quite what's called a serial entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. And he's still one of my biggest mentors and backers. He's at Scripps in La Jolla now. His name is Paul Schimmel, but he had founded Alkermes and Repligen before he founded Cubist Pharmaceuticals. And so he was very inspiring and just very, you know, open about let's do this work. And so he hired five biologists, and we were, you know, a good team. And so I just liked the teamwork, the camaraderie, you know, the challenge. There weren't rules. It was make up your rules. Just get, you know, we knew what the objective was. We wanted to identify new targets for, they're called isoleucel tRNA synthetases. But it was a whole new area for new antibiotics, both against bacteria and fungal diseases. Yeah. And, you know, it was the most exciting 5-year, you know, roller coaster ride, but quite exciting. And so then I just stayed in the Boston area with and worked in other capacities until I started work here.
Yeah, it's... there is a tremendous thrill and excitement to the startup world, right? And this notion of, you know, just there aren't rules, you're figuring it out, you know, it really does sort of unleash your creativity and the ownership that you have of it. And yeah, I can see it's still, it's a very exciting thing. All your projects are very thrilling for you. I can see. So is there any drawback to working in a startup that you might say? Because I do think a lot of young people now are very attracted to working in the startup world, but, you know, are there any things that you would sort of caution or that you've learned that you wish you knew?
Well, I think, you know, it's the soft skills. I think a lot of time, you know, you need the level of technical expertise and math, and, you know, you have to be able to make PowerPoint slides. You know, you need all those skills that you teach in BioBuilder. But then whether you're a good fit for a startup or a bigger company or academia or, you know, any other flavor, I think there's more uncertainty. I mean, and the pace of change is much greater. And so if you know, even though industry and pharmaceutical industry does have reorganizations, and it's not like any job would offer job security, but I still think the level of, you know, unknown for a startup company is simply greater. In pharma, you can move, there's more, it's a bigger team. So there's, you might have less impact, but then you might fit in easier. You're not noticed as much. In a startup company, sometimes, you know, when, you know, we're going to hire 3 people this year.
Wow.
It doesn't sound like a lot, but we're only 3 people now. So
you're
so
doubling. That's a big thing, right?
We're going to double our size. So each one of those hires has a huge impact on the company. And so some people thrive at that, and that excites them. But then other people, you know, it might scare you, or it might be like, well, I just want to sort of apprentice with somebody for a while. And so I think there's different fits. So understanding yourself and not trying to, you know, be something that you aren't, because there's so many different ways, different types of companies and different types of roles. The more you understand yourself, then the more you'll find a good fit, and it'll just feel right. And so I think that's really important. A lot of people just have, maybe they heard it from a professor or something. I know when I was a grad student, 90% of the professors thought you were selling out if you went to a company. So the feedback I got was, you know, like, oh, you're going to a that's, you must not feel, you must not have enough science, scientific, you know, passion if you're going to a company. And that was just the attitude, but you can't let those people influence you. You really just have to say, and it's funny that now things have completely changed, where almost every professor has their own company.
Yeah, certainly here in around Cambridge, Massachusetts, I think that is true. There is so much more support for the idea that if you have a great idea in academia, it's a wonderful thing to start a company and to move it into the world, right? Like, how could that ever be considered lesser? That's actually like greater good, right? Mm-hmm. So,
The founder of Cubist, Paul Schimmel, he used to joke that, he was a, tenured professor at MIT. He's, well recognized at Scripps. He helped create and form the whole Scripps, on the East Coast in Jupiter, Florida. I mean, he's just amazing. And he has repeatedly told us that he could never, he doesn't have what it takes to be full-time in industry. Mm-hmm. Like, he admires the, you need more perseverance mm-hmm. in industry, because you can't really change your goal. In academics, you can just go where the science takes you. And he has pivoted multiple times, but in industry, if you're going after a disease, you have to focus on that project.
Singularly focused on that. And that is the payoff, right? And that is where you're heading, right? No matter what obstacles come your way. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's so mm-hmm. interesting. It's lovely to hear you talk about him. Clearly his mentorship and model and approach to life meant a lot to you. I will to sort of add that you and I got connected because you had great interest in serving in that role for others. We have had BioBuilder students working with you and for you, and they've had a wonderful experience from our apprenticeship program into a summer internship with Eikonizo. Mm-hmm. So do you want to say just, what you look for in students, what you kind of hope to have as student, interns?
Yeah, I mean, because, we had two, Ramessa and Amma, and both of them were just fantastic. It's neat to still keep up with them. Now they're both, in their second year of college, which it's nice to serve. I'm writing a reference. Actually, it's reminding me it's due in a week for one of them. But I think the biggest thing was, critical thinking, nobody's an expert, but asking good questions. Like, if you don't understand something, don't fake it, and I have had, when I was at Harvard, I had to teach a couple classes, and some of the undergrads, they try to fake it, and it's so obvious, it. And so it's, there's no point in doing that, because it doesn't help me, it doesn't help the student, it doesn't help the project. And so the more honest you are, the better it is. Yeah. And so, but I think, so saying you don't know when you don't know, mm-hmm. and then also not being, being adaptable. And I think I felt a little guilty because Ramessa and Amma, sometimes there's just sort of, it doesn't take, a PhD to do some of this work. We wanted to organize, we had run a clinical trial and we needed to organize and make sure that we had all the documentation and well organized so that if we were audited, we would be able to show that. And, it took hours and hours, but that's what I think Ramessa did that project. She helped, just even little details, but making it, taking, owning it and making it really useful for us. So it saved, you know, it saved hours of my time so I could just, you know, do some other important things. And I think even working with the documents, it helped her understand like all the stuff that is entailed to run a clinical trial.
Absolutely.
So, you know, and I think the both Ama and Ramesa, it was just in part when you mentor someone, I want to feel like I'm actually helping them. Yeah. And so I think attitude says a lot, just, being happy to do whatever to, you know, as long as you're learning and you're in this environment, then, you know, it's all good. I think that helps the student and then it helps us as well.
Yes. And I know that both Ama and Ramesa loved their time working with you and learned so very much from it. And appreciated that feeling that you mentioned that, you know, it's more important to ask a good question than to be right or to sort of pretend that you were not wrong or don't know. I think that came through very clear, and that's really important learning, that flexibility, adaptability, humility, all those things, that it's really about getting it right, you know?
And there's no expectation, especially I think, both Ama and Ramesa were seniors seniors in high school.
Yeah.
And, you know, they were thinking they probably wanted to go to medical school. They, you know, I think they also had a little interest on the business side. And so I still sort of feel like I don't know what I want to be when I grow up. So how can I expect, you know, a 17 or 18 year old to know? I think it's just, you know, whether it's you're living in the moment, you know, so there's a lot of focus on mindfulness, but you just want to enjoy and get as much out of the current experience as you can.
Yeah.
And whether you pursue that as a career path or not, all I care for Ama and Ramesa is that they find the future fit for them.
Yeah.
And so the more they want to know, if they're interested in this as a career path, we'll provide that. But I also have a lot of connections and know people who are in different career paths, and I can, you know, help provide them information on those as well. But I think just getting out of that, whatever they want.
Yeah, that's come up in a couple of ways that it really is about building a network, because as you said, you know, you might be working with somebody under sort of one current understanding of what they want to do or where they're headed. If that shifts, it's fine, because you may know somebody who could help them with that shift, and that is part of mentorship, that it's not any kind of it's not a failure. It's actually a tremendous success when right? You know, it's a great thing for everybody to be able to turn around and help the next in line, even if they're not heading down the same path that you're heading, you know?
Yeah. Or especially great. Because, you know, that way then I learn even more. Mm-hmm. I don't want to make, you know, a clone of myself or something. I want to, I think Ramesa wrote me that she is like secretary of this, it's a society for, you know, honor students at UMass.
Wow.
So she's having to learn things like, Robert's Rules of Order and taking meeting minutes. And I just laughed because, I'm having to do that to run my board meetings.
Yeah.
And and so she's learning it, you know, as a freshman in college.
Yep. Yep. And I learned it. I had a board meeting yesterday and I learned it to run. we are all, like I said, good learners. Boy, that's a wonderful thing. So I do have one a little bit offbeat question for you, and then maybe we'll ask if there are questions from the students. But have you been bicycling through all this? I know that you normally bike to work. We have snow here. Have you been biking through all this?
Well, if it weren't for COVID, I would have. I used to bike from, you know, just the 3 miles from the train to the lab. And now my bike has been sitting I guess it's been since March 12th. Mm-hmm. I have a bike at home and then a bike, my commuting bike. So my commuting bike is, I don't even know if it's still there in the basement of the train station. Well, I keep thinking I should drive in just to see if my bike is still there.
Yeah. Well, maybe on the anniversary of having left it, it has been a long time. I do miss seeing you around the lab, but boy, I am grateful that you took the time to talk about your really just wonderful, fascinating company and all the wonderful world that startup communities really can be and how exciting they are. You know, for people who are interested in sure. scientific things and building things and good applications to the world and things mm-hmm. like that. So,